Take your drawing to the next level with this watercolor drip Zentangle artwork. Start out by using watercolor paper and do random drips in any colors that you would like. This is really fun, it's simple, and it goes super quick. Then take any pen or drawing utensil of your choice and add patterns in the negative spaces that are left behind. This is really therapeutic. It's a great way to practice your pen and ink techniques, and it just makes for really vivid and gorgeous results. If you love learning about art, please hit that subscribe button so you never miss one of my weekly art tutorials. So this is what the background of my watercolor drip paper looks like, and click the link above to learn how I did it. It's just as easy as it sounds. You're dripping watercolor on paper. Make sure it is 100% dry before you start drawing. I'm using a fine tip Sharpie, but I have a lot of drawing pens that I also love. I'll put every material I use in the description box below. Getting started, find an empty space that's not intimidating. I usually like to start with a small to medium one, and at this point I'm just kind of warming up my hand. So I'm choosing a pattern that I've doodled a lot. It's kind of like a scallop pattern, and I like this one because it's fairly simple. This is a smallish space, so it's a small detail that will fill up the space nicely. I don't know about you, but when I start drawing, my hand's always a little bit shaky. And Sharpies are great for making a really dark line, but sometimes you can see the shakiness of my hand through the Sharpie. So again, use whatever materials you would like, and a colorful pen would also be a great choice. I always give a shout out to the Zentangle method, which you can find at zentangle.com when I'm doing one of these doodles. No, they did not invent the doodle, but they have a really great website with very structured patterns that you can follow step by step. When I do this, I kind of go back and forth between really structured and then more intuitive. I'm just kind of letting my hand and brain decide what's next. So right now I'm going into my smaller space and I'm filling it up with concentric lines, still kind of warming up my hand and my brain to what I want to do. This next pattern, I'm going to try and do a lot of like black and white areas, and I want it to look a little bit like an animal print. So you could start with the pencil, but I like to kind of just freehand it and just let whatever happens, happens. This is supposed to be a really freeing, thoughtful work of art that kind of happens as you go. You certainly can pre-plan it, but for me, I'm just letting my mind and hand kind of wander and figuring it out as I go. So I'm drawing organic shapes, which have curved lines and edges, and I'm trying to have similar shapes, but with slightly different sizes and shapes. So right now it kind of reminds me of giraffe print. And if you're a beginner, this is a great start, but I always try and pay attention to line quality and how much area of black and white I have. So this is a really large space. I did my drips on this paper at more of a diagonal. And so I'm gonna go back in and I'm just gonna fill in the negative space or the blank space behind the pattern with a thick black Sharpie. I'm going to speed this up because I'm simply coloring in a solid shape with a black Sharpie. So if this is too fast for you, pause it. So the next step is I still think my pattern is a little plain. So I'm going back and adding a smaller organic shape similar to the big shape, and I'm coloring that in too. Maybe it's just my brain, but I'm seeing avocados or fried eggs, and I'm still kind of going for like a very natural, almost animal print. Nothing in particular. I'm kind of making this up as I go. Really happy with this pattern because of the contrast. It has really nice areas of dark and light, and I've always been drawn to that in works of art. I like those heavy contrasts, really two opposites next to each other. I'm also a big fan of organic shapes. They're really fun to do, and it just matches my brain. Now, since everything I've done is pretty loosey-goosey, I'm gonna pick up my ruler and try to do a more structured geometric pattern. We'll see how that goes. So even now, I'm not exactly sure what I'm going to do. I'm thinking maybe a checkerboard, and so I'm going across creating stripes. So it just depends on what you're interested in. You might be the type of person that loves structure, that loves geometry, and you might use that ruler on every single shape. I'm quite the opposite. I prefer kind of organic shapes. I like to kind of freehand it. And so I'm gonna try and do a balance of the two. So from here, I think stripes is a little too boring for me. So I am gonna do a checkerboard. And I'm gonna flip my ruler and cross my horizontal lines with a vertical line, trying to keep my squares fairly consistent. I am just eyeballing it. I'm not gonna measure every single box because that sounds terrible. A little trick I picked up is with a checkerboard, you're doing every other at a diagonal. So before I color anything in, so I don't make a mistake, because you can't erase the Sharpie, I'm just gonna kind of dot and map out where my black shapes will be and what I'm leaving white. I love that there's a little bit of green splatter that I accidentally created when drip painting. And then I'm just gonna go in and just fill it in a basic checkerboard. I think that will be a really nice contrast to the black and white, more organic pattern that I finished earlier. I'm going to time-lapse this because I'm simply using a thick Sharpie to fill in my boxes. If this is too fast for you, make sure to rewind it, press pause, and go at your own pace if you're doing this at home. Okay, my next pattern, I'm trying something weird, and a quick search of Zentangle patterns on the internet is what I always do just to kind of get my mind right with what I like. Sometimes I know exactly what patterns I'd like to do, and then sometimes I want to be inspired by what's done before. So I'm going to call this the rainbow and bacon pattern. Okay, stay with me. So the first kind of curve lines, I'm doing different line variety, and now I'm going to draw a shape that's a little bit more like bacon. I always make food references because that's just me. So you can see I'm adding lines on the inside just kind of randomly, and I'm making at least one of them thicker than the rest. Line variety and line quality is really important when doing a Zentangle. It'd be really boring if I used the same style of line, the same line weight, so thickness or thinness of a line, and variety is the spice of life and your Zentangle. So I'm going to repeat, and this time I'm doing an upside down rainbow, kind of filling in this larger space, making sure to focus on having different weights or thicknesses of my line. So I'm kind of feeling like it's not coming together yet, but I know I'm gonna fill in the negative space or the background with black. So I'm having faith that if I just keep going, it's gonna turn out okay. And that's the beauty of this. You don't have to copy what someone's done before. Be loose and let it kind of change and grow as you're drawing. So I'm gonna overlap a few of them so the pattern seems connected to each other. And I am drawing an outline where my pen is touching the pink paint and the outer edges created by the watercolor drip. Going back and editing the line here so I can really tell, you know, which is the rainbow and which is the bacon, or really just the curved lines or the wavy lines. So I'm gonna repeat this and just kind of fill up my space. So I'm gonna speed things up just a little bit since I'm just as I'm going, adjusting my lines, adding more of these shapes, and making sure that they interact with each other. This pattern was a risk for me because I'm doing it permanently in pen, and I've never tried it or practiced it before. The best way to get better at drawing is to draw. So don't be afraid to try things you haven't done before, and don't be afraid to fail. If the pattern looks weird, ask yourself why, and then see how you can change it so that you like it. So now what I'm gonna do is take my thick Sharpie again, just because I don't want to bleed or take away a lot of the ink of the fine tip Sharpie. So if you're using your good drawing pens, you might wanna get one of those really thick ones, like the brush pen. And I'm just gonna go in and fill in the negative space so that it's black instead of white. And that's gonna give more interest to my wavy lines and make it just a more interesting pattern to look at. So as you're doodling, as you're filling in with your patterns, just always ask yourself, does it need to be darker? Does it need to be lighter? And I do wanna save these green splatters because I love how they contrast with the pink. So I'm just giving it like a little white border so that you can see that really nice splatter. I have this cute little neighboring section that makes me think of a flower. So I'm just adding a few little lines in the center and spreading it out so it looks like a flower. And not every section has to have tons of detail. It depends on what its neighbors are. It depends on how large it is. And so this is just kind of like a quick little moment that I'm not super happy with. So I know I'll go back and kind of touch it up. This next pattern is something I've been doing for years. I remember sitting in class doodling, and I call this the hair or the spaghetti pattern. And so I start by drawing a series of swirls going different directions, and then I use concentric lines that build on each other to fill in the space. I just love this pattern. This is one, like I said, I've done a lot, so I don't need a reference image. I'm just kind of going with it. And I'm sure that you, if you've been drawing a lot, have a pattern that you kind of go to. So don't be afraid to do something that you're really comfortable with, that you really enjoy. Doing a Zentangle is all about peaceful mindfulness, and it's a great way to really just plug into your thoughts. So you could be playing music, you could be listening to a podcast, even have a TV show on the background, or you could just simply let your thoughts kind of swirl as you're drawing. So it's a great way to practice mindfulness. It's a great way to kind of focus your energy, focus your brain, focus your hand on what you're doing without distractions. So it just depends on where you are in your life and what it is you're trying to achieve. And this pattern, I just love how it's planned, but it also is random because however you fill up the space, you have these kind of empty little triangles or empty kind of organic shapes left behind that you can fill in with your concentric lines. And I just can imagine sticking a fork down in this pattern and twirling it like spaghetti. Again, always have food on the brain, that's just me. I'm gonna wrap this one up and speed along just a little bit since you've seen me do the pattern before. And now I'm gonna move on to this section on the corner of my paper, and my inspiration here are wavy stripes. I love stripes, I think they're really fun. And for this one, I'm gonna do a wavy stripe, which is just a satisfying version of stripes. So you can see this is super boring as is, especially compared to the detailed pattern to the left of it. So always compare your patterns to what's neighboring it and ask yourself, what does it need? Because that pattern is so black and white, I want this one to be more about small lines. And so I'm just gonna kind of go in and double up one of the center lines to give it a little bit more detail. Even now looking at it, I think that is boring still. So I'm gonna add a little design on the inside of each one to give it a little bit more interest. So I'm doing hatch marks or like a vertical stripe. On the second one, I'm doing dots. And on the third one, I'm gonna do a zigzag. And since I can't think of any other ones, I'm just gonna repeat. So I'm gonna go back to that hatch mark or that vertical stripe. Then I'll go back to my little dots, which is a very satisfying pattern, by the way. Now, if you're smashing your pen, you're doing it wrong, especially if you're borrowing maybe your art teacher's pen. You don't need to like stab it. A tiny dot will do with a nice drawing pen, and you don't wanna mess up the tip of it. So, I'm seeing snakes right now. And so I wanna kinda give it even more small detail, because again, I'm looking at what's neighboring it, and I want small lines so it appears more gray and not black and white like the neighboring pattern. So I'm just kind of going in and adding a little bit more detail, and you can always go back and add and adjust as you go. So I'm gonna make some of the lines a little bit thicker, some a little thinner, just like I talked about before, focusing on contrast and balancing out your line weight, your black and white contrast to make it a really satisfying to look at Zentangle. So you're not only exercising your brain, you're gonna fill your hand with this. That's why they call it artwork, because you're putting a lot of work and effort, and really it depends on how much watercolor drip you did. This next space is fairly small. I mean, it's more of the medium sized shapes, and I'm realizing how much organic patterns I've done, and so I'm going back to my old friend the ruler, and I think I'm gonna do just a traditional brick pattern with this one. I think because I have so much black and white next to it, and because I have so many wavy lines, I wanna balance that out with doing some more open space with a lot of white, with a really straight and structured pattern. I think brick always looks nice. It's like a checkerboard with a slight variation. And I like that this one has so much green splatter in it. I think that will give the brick effect a really nice vibe. So you can see I'm trying to do a horizontal line, pretty accurate, trying to just eyeball it and make the thickness of the white space as equal as I can. Now here's the tricky part. Unlike a checkerboard, you need to skip every other line. So I'm laying down my ruler horizontally, and you can see I'm skipping it and then spacing it out. If this stresses you out, use a pencil first. So one mistake I'm making right now is I'm covering up the brick pattern that I've done before. And so I recommend putting your ruler on the right-hand side so that you can actually see, or the opposite of wherever you started, so that you can see where you need to add your line. And if you sense my hesitation, that's because, like I said, I'm kind of uncomfortable with geometric structured shapes. With organic shapes, you can say, oh, I meant to do that. But with a brick pattern, if you make a mistake, spoiler alert, I do, it's pretty obvious that something is wrong. I always like doing patterns where there is no wrong answer, because you're making it up as you go. I still think it looks pretty nice, and I still am just kind of eyeballing it. Again, use a pencil if that makes you feel nervous, and remember, you're skipping every other line. So bricks are like a checkerboard that's catty corner. So now I'm looking at it and something seems off. I think that top brick is too small, and I also feel like it's a lot of blank space. So remember those dots I did in the stripes? I'm just gonna give a little bit of dots on the edge of the line that I drew to give it like a 3D, just more detailed effect. So I can already tell that I made a mistake. See how the top brick is really long, and then that small brick there, that line should have actually been pushed up one. But whatever, this is my Zentangle. I'm noticing it now and I'm like, ooh, can't erase it, so just go with it. I also like how these little dots match the green splatter. And I do like, I think I made a smart choice to put this next to that really heavy black pattern next to it, because then it doesn't look empty, it looks balanced. This next pattern is really fun. You could call it the bullseye. And what I do is I draw a dot with at least two circles around it. So this is a really fun pattern, and it's really simple. It's I like how the patterns kind of overlap. Sometimes they look like eyeballs swimming together. And this one, you just kind of fill up your space randomly. And if you have extra space, you can fill it in with black. I really like this one too for this in particular because it's very crowded. And I feel like this kind of crowded circle, it's almost like a crowd of eyeballs. I think it just works really well for this tight little space. And I'm gonna speed this along since I'm just simply repeating the dot with the two circles around it. Sometimes I get called out in the comments for going too fast, but keep in mind this video would be like 2 hours long if I did it as is. So please go at your own pace. You can always pause it. When I teach this in the classroom, we just do it like parts and pieces at a time. So I've been avoiding this section from the start because it's the biggest, and the biggest section kind of in the middle is going to stand out. So I'm gonna try and do this pattern that I saw on the internet when I Googled Zentangle patterns with my own spin on it, of course. And it's going to be triangles where there are lines inside of them that rotate with each triangle. I know that's a terrible description, but you'll see what I mean from here. So basically I'm drawing a line, and now see I'm rotating my ruler, making another triangular shape, and then I'm gonna do lines in that one that are different from what's right next to it. So that's gonna make a really cool braided effect. It's gonna look like the triangles are kind of twisting and interacting, and it really gives it a cool 3D twisting effect. So I'm not thinking too much about what my triangles look like or how big they are. I just know they each need to be slightly different. I am gonna make a darker line so that each triangle has its own voice and its own shape. And it's very important that each triangle rotates or flips so that it looks different from the one next to it. So you can see I'm doing more of a vertical, not perfectly vertical, but a vertical stripe next to a diagonal stripe. And then for this one, I'm gonna do more straight up and down. You'll see as I go, it's hard to explain. And again, I'm a visual person, so I'm kind of feeling it out as I go. I'm gonna speed things up a little bit since I'm feeling more confident with my pattern making. And again, pause, rewatch, do what you need to do if you're following along at home. And keep in mind, just because I'm explaining the steps that I'm taking, every Zentangle, every drawing is gonna be completely different depending on the artist who's doing it. So if you're looking for inspiration, I'm gonna tell you all about what I'm thinking as I'm drawing. But yours can be wherever you need yours to be. I've had students make the most amazing Zentangles that are much more simple than mine, and I've had students do patterns where each one has a theme. Like they'll draw flowers, they'll draw space themes, they'll draw little characters, emojis. So I'm keeping mine very pattern and line based, but yours could be a whole bunch of whatever you're good or interested in drawing. So come at your level, use the materials you're comfortable with. This is just a great way to get better at drawing because it doesn't have to represent anything. I think sometimes a blank piece of paper is so scary. And with this, you're starting out with really pretty colors. It's already satisfying to look at. And then you're just filling it up with patterns at your skill level. Also keep in mind, not every work of art that's done needs to be hung up at some display somewhere. It can be just for you. And the experience of creating is good enough as is. If you're just trying to create, it doesn't have to be good enough for anyone else. It just has to be an experience. I'm going to time lapse this because what I'm doing is the same, creating a semi-triangular shape, rotating my lines so that the stripes are different. And I'm also making some of the lines wider or closer together just to give it more visual interest. So if you really like this pattern, make triangular shapes, they don't have to be perfect, rotate your stripes, and if you're looking for even more interest, make some of the stripes really close together and some of the stripes even more far apart to create more lighter areas and darker areas of gray. Also, outline your section to really give it a pop. I have another really tiny little section, and so I'm gonna fill this in with stippling, or those tiny little dots that I did in the stripe section before. Remember, if you're destroying your pen, you can hear your pen, or your pen is changing shape, you're pressing down too hard. Speaking of tiny sections, I really hate this little flower, so I'm gonna outline it and just know that, okay, it's not my favorite section, and that's life. I am procrastinating a little bit by outlining sections I've done before, adding some more areas of dark, because I'm not really sure what I wanna do for my final sections. With this Zentangle, I'm gonna not repeat patterns as often as usual. If I were doing this at a larger scale or maybe I had more sections to fill, I would definitely repeat patterns that I like. For this smaller scale Zentangle, I think I'm gonna try and come up with a new pattern for each one. So I really enjoyed that black and white organic one that I did. I believe it was my first one. And so I'm gonna kind of mimic a teardrop shape similar to what I did, but less animal print and more teardrop or water droplet. And then I'm gonna copy that similar style where I take a Sharpie and after I draw each shape that's similar, but a little bit different each time, I'm gonna fill it in with a black Sharpie. So that's similar and I really like the black and white effect. I think it stands out very nicely with the colorful watercolor drip paper. And I'm using the thicker Sharpie to do this because I'm trying to protect the really nice fine point on my smaller Sharpie. Once you ruin it, you know, it's like nothing better than a brand new pen or a brand new Sharpie. I've got this little satisfying space up here and I'm gonna do a pretty basic zigzag stripe pattern. I am running out of steam a little bit, so if you feel yourself feeling overwhelmed or fatigued, take a break. Do something different, stand up, walk around, stretch your hands, come back to it another day, unless you're in an art class and a teacher makes you work on it for a specific amount of time. You know, go at your own pace, especially if you're doing this for mindfulness. If you're feeling overwhelmed, then stop, take a break, and come back to it. So for this pattern, I'm gonna copy. Now I'm remembering the first pattern I did was the like scallop or scale pattern. And so I'm gonna kind of repeat that design, but at a larger scale, get it? And so this should look like a mermaid tail or fish. And it's a U shape that you catty corner everyone to give it that fish scale quality. So I'm not gonna leave it as simple as this because I've put so much more detail or at least areas of dark and light that it just seems very plain. So I'm going to outline that first line to give it a little bit more line variety and just make it look more emphasized. And so I'm just gonna kind of double my speed here because I'm simply outlining a line that I already drew. I already like this better, but I have an idea to make this even more detailed and it won't take that much more effort. So once I've outlined everything, I'm gonna go in and add this little U shape where the scales overlap. And I think this just makes it really interesting. And instead of like a mermaid tail, it makes me think of barnacles or something that you would see on like a coral reef. And I just think a small amount of detail gives it a really nice finishing touch. Okay, wow, I'm done. I can't believe that I filled up every space. I'm loving the color. I'm loving the contrast. This was really fun to do. I've been going through a lot and having this moment to just sit down and focus on mark making and drawing was really therapeutic for me. Thank you so much for sticking around and making art with me. And if you're interested in more Zentangle tutorials, boy, I've got you covered. Check these out. Also check out my website, thatartteacher.com. If you're an art teacher or educator, I have full length lesson plans and student examples. And if you're interested in what my students are doing in my classroom, find me on Instagram at thatartteacher_Machado.